T-minus 23 seconds and counting.
Go ahead, C-Safety.
Yeah, be advised that sequence 16, step 592 complete.
T-minus 15, 14. We have a go for main engine start. 2-1-0.
They knew you from dunking from college. That doesn't mean that you can't play the game. And that's a stereotype that you just got to break. And the only way you can break it is by proving them wrong.
I was a very quiet kid. I didn't talk too much because I had a speech problem. So when people made fun of me, then we stepped on the basketball court, I made them look bad, so I got a lot of respect that way.
Oh, what an assortment of moves and a shot!
Out and enjoy yourself, because I just love doing the things I do best, and that's playing basketball and enjoying the people I'll be around.
Well, the game is fun. The guys from the past have really created all of this. We're just following in their glory, and they made the game what it is today. We're just happy to be a part of it.
Thank you.
I was pumping gas in Worcester here while all this was going on, not worried too much about it, one way or the other. Finally, somebody called me up and said, hey, Walter Brown picked your name out of the hat. Well, I drove 40 miles down to Boston, signed a contract with Walter, and played the only place, really, that I would have played.
Coosie and I had an understanding. I didn't care how he threw the ball, as long as somebody caught it.
Hit the open man, and when you got the ball, you were just in the position where you could take the shot. You never got the ball before you got to your position. Coosie would not give it to you.
I used to talk to him about conceptualizing in basketball. And he used to ask me, what do you mean by that? I said, you have to think one, two, maybe three patterns ahead of time what's going to happen.
Labeled very young as a showman. I drove down my bag between my legs to throw different type of unique passes and things of this nature. I would describe myself as a player that loved to run, was able to handle a fast break as well as anybody. I believe people, especially myself, recognized the opportunity that we had to not only like go out and play a game and win and so forth, but to try to bring fans back. You have to do something other than just put the ball in the hoop. I was more of a scorer because I could handle the ball so well that it was really impossible for somebody to guard me in a one-on-one situation. Be remembered as a person that played the game with great intensity and love for the game, but also played it for one standpoint, to entertain the fans.
Sitting down on the sidelines while they were playing in the playgrounds and, you know, with holes in my sneakers and waiting for a chance that maybe these guys will let me play. All of a sudden, you know, they'll look around and they'll look and look and say, oh, come on, Earl, you can play. When I first got into the league, my game was so chastised because it was, they said I was a one-on-one ball player, I was a schoolyard ball player, this and that and that and this. But then, you know, because I could think the game and I knew, you know, something about the game itself, I realized that it was something a little bit special.
When you had Earl Monroe on the team, doing some of the things that he could do with a basketball, it was fun to sit there and watch it. I used to kick it out and just lay back and just see what they were gonna do.
After a while, I got to know my audience, and I became, you know, more than just a basketball player, I became a performer. And by knowing your audience, you know what you can do to excite your audience. That's how, you know, the so-called pearl became evident. A lot of the things that I felt as though I was going to do in my career, I didn't do because of the fact I came to New York.
Earl Monroe once caused me nightmares because when he was with Baltimore, he was such a devastating player to guard and such a showman that, you know, he's the type of guy you didn't want to score on you because he made you look bad.
Monroe was a magician, you know, he knew how to get the way he had to go. They thought he was just another flamboyant guy that shoots all the time and, you know, does all these fancy things, but that was not Earl. Earl was a very, very intelligent basketball player, could make the plays, pass the ball, and another guy that was desperate to win a championship.
eventually my game became accepted, and now people look back and see it as maybe the inception of the new game. It's kind of strange because I go to a playground maybe, and younger kids might not know me as such, you know, but I hear them say, he's Pearlin.
I had a lot of doubts because of my size. Back then, they had Earl Monroe was in the league. He was 6'3", 6'4". I was about 6 feet when I came out, and I would say I weighed about 150, and those guys was twice as big as me. I enjoyed playing basketball. I had a devotion for it, and I felt that this is one of the games that I really wanted, really truly wanted to learn, and I wanted to learn it while I was young because I felt that at that particular time I didn't really know how good I was going to be. But I thought my body was just indestructible. I mean, I can go out there and run, penetrate, go into different things, and, you know, I get scarred or I might bleed and stuff like that, but I'm gonna keep playing. It's like, you know, all you have to do is oil me up and I'm out there doing my thing.
Realizing that my dream was about to become reality, those were the hardest 5 minutes of my life. Every time I step on the court, I'm going to think about that day in June when I was selected 18th and 17 guys went ahead of me. When I was a youngster, dreaming about becoming a New York Knick, dreaming about bringing the ball up court and running the show and hitting game-winning baskets, I believed it, no question. But I didn't know if I could pull it off.
Mark Jackson, look out, look it!
Mark Jackson down the lane, spinning and scooping on a hook, and he hit it.
I watched the great players who had the poise. So every time I watched the game, I imagined myself in their position. What would you do if it was 20 seconds left on the clock and your team down 1 or 2 points?
Three, Jackson from three, yes!
God's responsibility is to run the club, know who should get the ball, when they should get it, and where they should get it.
When Mark gets the ball, the crowd comes to their feet, especially on a fast break, because he has a knack of doing something fancy with the ball, behind the back pass, between the leg dribble, and of course the New York fans really like that style of play.
just like a singer, actor, basketball players, and athletes, entertainers. I take a picture of everybody on the floor when I get the ball. When I take it down the lane, no matter what I do with it, I know where everybody's at.
Jackson for Ewing.
Trying every herky-jerky move that you can, just so that you can get them on their heels, and then you attack them.
Jackson off a crossover with a gorgeous move.
My main goal is building something for the future and winning.
Basketball to me is a freedom. When I walk in between those four lines on the basketball court, nothing comes into my mind but basketball. Just incredible freedom that I have. It's almost as a bird flying. The most satisfaction I get out of making a good pass is a score at the end of the pass. Just the idea of fooling somebody, or tricking somebody, or say, I caught you, boom. It just gives me a thrill. You know, I get a great sense of enjoyment out of it.
Dale Ellis quickly turns it around. Rebound by McHale. It's a 24-point game. Great pass to Jordan. That was a highlight. Ooh.
It's like a magician. Like a magician does a trick and I fooled you.
Isaiah breaks up the lane, falls, but keeps the dribble twice. Now comes back toward the lane, to the hoop, up in, off the glass, and he's fouled. Holy cow.
5 seconds. Plenty of time to get a shot. 3 seconds. Plenty of time.
You're looking at one of the most spectacular players in the game, a person who has abilities that surface during the year, but at crucial times, he reaches another level of performance.
Here's Isaiah. Let's see what he got. All the way up. Go!
He loves to compete. He loves the big-time, showtime atmosphere, and he's usually at his best. He'll probably do something very unique tonight.
When my brother played here, I always wished that I could play with him. It would make my life a whole lot easier. With him running up the court, dishing off passes, going to the bucket, I mean, he's the point guard. If you want to say point guard to play with, he's one of the top guys.
I don't think I'll ever be able to find anything that gives me the sense of enjoyment, the sense of pleasure that I get out of basketball.
Thank you.
trying to go deep. Cannon, now he does on Perkins, throws up a prayer, banks in, and he's fouled.
Out on the court, I can express myself. So it's like, whew, like you come down this way, dunk.
Matthews, beautiful basketball.
Some 360, you know, hoopsie doo, banger road. Then he come back, the sky hook.
Matthews against Humphries, back in a minute, down the middle, a hook shot of five in the way.
Yeah, you know, you come back to fancy pass.
They're both back by Tuesday when they'll call it different.
So you're just going back. Well, it's like a tennis match. And if you go down to reach for the popcorn, you might miss something.
Magic pass. Oh, under the Worthy. Slam dunk.
Magic's just a great basketball player. He's the best I've ever seen, you know. Unbelievable. I don't know what to say.
Magic Johnson, one of the best, if not the very best player that ever played a game. Outstanding player, an even better person.
Magic Johnson would definitely be the best point guard to ever play the game. He's something to watch, you know what I'm saying? There's not a lot of players in the league I would pay, to, you know, to pay to watch.
If he came over once a week like the college show, I'd sit there and watch.
He's always got the smile going. He's always getting the crowd excited and forcing everybody to play well.
I want to be the best. I want to win. And that's why I play, because I want to win. Not just to be playing, not just to make a lot of money. I want to win.
String some hoops together. Jordan all the way to the hole. Cut out! Right over, Mike Brown, and through the foul.
to the baseline.
I just know, you know, anytime Chicago comes in town, you have to leave your family and everybody else home. You don't want to be embarrassed.
Gordon gets in.
I remember an alley-oop went up in the air on the fast break, and I just knew I was going to get the ball. And all of a sudden, Jordan went up about 10 or 12 more notches than I did. It's something that I'll never forget, but definitely a joy to watch. And when you're playing against him, you're not ashamed to say, you stand there in awe.
The guy literally is embarrassing the league. He's got good. He's a phenomenal player. There isn't anything he can't do.
Oh, you find yourself watching sometimes because, you know he's going to do something, you know, that you might not see again.
How does he do that? How does he do that? How does he know?
Michael Jordan is one in a million player. They don't come along very often.
Jordan. Here's Michael at the foul line. A shot on Elo. Good!
The Bulls win it! They win it!
Set the Cleveland Cavaliers. Michael Jordan hits it at the
When I'm on my game, when I'm really on like I was in Boston, I don't think it's too many people that can stop me. I don't think it's anybody that can stop me. And once I got off to a good start, it felt like I couldn't stop. You know, I could run for days. I just wish that the game didn't have to stop. We could play on and on. We'd probably still be playing now the way I felt. If I get the ball, you're at mercy of whatever I want to do. And there's nothing that you can say or do about it if I'm on my game. The feeling is like you own. You own the ball, you own the game, you own the guy who's guarding you. You can actually play him like a puppet.
Michael on the drive across the lane. Turnaround shot. Got it.